So, Linda's here and she brought a guest, our friend Laura Sherman. So, welcome to the show, Laura.
Thank you so much.
And Linda, why don't you intro us and tell us a little bit about what you girls have cooked up for us.
All right. Well, being me, I always come up with these ideas of like what is wonderful and what would people want to know. And I know Laura from Clearwater a few years back. I was always helping the Community Learning Center. As everyone knows, Consumer Energy Solutions, where I work, is a big sponsor of the Community Learning Center. But years ago, Laura did a really cool thing. You know how on the radio, I'm always asking you people to come and stop by and do something with Community Learning Center. Well, Laura is a chess whiz. I don't know if that's a term. It's kind of like cheese whiz, chess whiz. And she, because I don't know how to even move one thing, so that's why she's a whiz. But she wrote a book on it, I believe, and she did a huge community effort where she had a free chess club, and it got big. And I would walk in a Community Learning Center, and it was just like chess going on everywhere, all different age groups. And
it was so much fun.
It was so much fun, right? Yeah. And people were coming in. Anyway, so that's how I know Laura. And then I was really getting to know her adorable kids. She has three kids, two little girls and a boy who are now very big. And just when we were getting to be friendly, she was like, yeah, we're going on the road. And I'm like, okay, you're going on a road trip. She's like, yeah, it's kind of a long one. And I went, what are you doing? And she's like, we're going to road school. And I went, what's that? And she will
explain. It's kind of it's like homeschool on the road.
You got it. Right. You got it. Right. I want to introduce you to Laura. I'm going to let you, her tell you a little bit about, one, why road schooling, and welcome, Laura.
Well, thank you so much. It's such an honor to be here. I really appreciate it. We started about 2.5 years ago. We just hit the road. We sold our house in Dunedin. My husband and I have lived here for 20 years. And we decided it was time to do something different. So we got on the road, and we've been homeschooling for a little bit, and I found that homeschooling really was taking place too much in the home for my taste.
Yeah.
So I wanted to go out and see different places and still educate the children in some of the traditional manners, but also take them out and use our museums and national parks and really get out there. And educate, you know, you can teach history by walking the path.
Mm-hmm. Now listen to this. There's also a different type of museum, which Laura told me about today, called a live museum. And so speaking of walking the path, she told me a little story that she should tell you right now about the difference between a live museum and another museum.
Mm-hmm. That's right. They're actually all around America. We have a lot of them. And you can go, for instance, in Massachusetts, there's one that's called the Plymouth Plantation. You can go there, and actors actually pretend they're from a different era.
Well, my brother lives in Plymouth.
Oh, yeah. Kidding!
Yeah, and his wife is one of the curators at the
museum. Oh, my gosh!
That's wonderful. Yeah. That is an amazing place. I mean, my kids love to ask questions. Mm. So they really get into the whole thing, and the actors are so good. They never break character, and they're always from that era. Mm-hmm. So you can ask, what did you eat then? And they actually have food being prepared at that time. They are living it. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we're doing. We're living it, too, on the road. So it's a great mesh, and I just love that. And, you know, some museums are just more your traditional museums, but there was one in Houston, for instance, that we went to that had these amazing science stations with state-of-the-art microscopes and experiments where you can, you know, cut the chromosome of the fruit fly, and you can do blood testing and all this amazing thing. And, you know, it teaches you how to do it, so I don't have to be. I mean, I'm a college graduate, but I wouldn't have been able to do this had I not had the step-by-step manual sitting there. Yeah. It's very easy, and, you know, my kids are 9, 11, and 14. When we started, they were, you know, 2.5 years younger, so the youngest was 6, right? So, yeah, so there's so many different places you can go, and the national parks are an education. Oh, another thing is a Junior Ranger program.
Wow. Do you have to be like a full member for that, or how does that work?
That's in all our national parks pretty much, and the state parks often have it, even sometimes the regional parks. Even here in Florida, you can go, and they're great educational tools, and the kids actually earn a little badge, and they become a junior ranger.
Wow.
And they learn about nature, and they do different exercises. It's very hands-on, which is what I am as an educator.
Well, what is that? What is the cutoff on Junior Ranger? Because I'm thinking just skill-wise, I don't know that I would even remotely try to sign up for Ranger. Would they reject me?
No, actually, I've seen adults do it. And I should have been doing it with my kids, but I'm more herding them all the time.
And taking pictures.
Yeah, taking pictures, that's right. But my daughter, I have to remember to ask her to bring it on Saturday, but she has a vest with about 30 different Junior Ranger pins, cool, and patches. Sometimes they're just gorgeous.
Oh, my gosh. So, see, I'm not too old, and I don't have to join Girl Scouts and try to get those badges. I think I would stand out in that group. But it sounds like I could fit in with the Junior Rangers. I want to do it.
It's wonderful. Well, it's a bit of a fun adventure. And, you know, one thing that people ask me sometimes is, you know, can you really afford that? Can the average person really afford to go on the road?
Yeah.
And I, you know, we've learned how to really get some good deals and you know, camp. We have an RV that's 36-foot RV with two bathrooms, a residential refrigerator, everything.
Ooh.
And we've figured out how to just park at any old place and not pay. And it's called boondocking. And there's places that the government actually has, like, earmarked for you.
Isn't that beautiful? Like, who would know that? Yeah. I didn't know that.
We do campgrounds, too. But it's fun to go out.
And they have private campgrounds and they have state campgrounds, right? So I'm imagining, like, I was thinking the only camping that I did with our little mini RV was the state of Florida, and it was beautiful and I loved it. And there were some state parks and then other private places. And I think probably about 5 years ago, it was easily 35 a night. What is it now?
It can be that. You can find them for 20. And sometimes if you're really clever, you can find really good deals. There was one, I think it was Ohio, where they had a special where it was $5 a night.
Look at that.
Everything.
Mm. Really? With the breakfast?
No.
Oh, did I hear breakfast?
You're thinking holiday.
Hookups. Yeah, okay. It was hookup, not breakfast.
We're talking about camping. Okay.
I do the glamping version, but I'm sorry. I did not mean to interrupt. So, but $5 for the hookup.
Yeah, that was that. You get electricity, special. You get to have water, and you get to be able to dump, which is kind of a handy thing.
We understand the dumping.
So there's a lot of different places, but for instance, when we went to Yellowstone and we checked out, I love Yellowstone.
What state did you go to Yellowstone in?
We went through, we hit both sides, and so we were camping in Idaho, and then we went up through, I guess it was Wyoming, and so we hit, but we went all around.
Yeah. I've been to Wyoming.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
It's gorgeous. Yeah. It's amazing.
And the wildlife. To see all this live and to see the country live is great for the kids.
That's my thought.
And you know, when you're an adult, you see it, you enjoy it. But when you're a kid, I think it just is special.